Good morning.
Good morning.
It's Mother's Day. Look at that, there's a great smile right there. We ought to put him up here on the stage and turn him around as an example of how everybody should look. Praise the Lord. You know what? He has an understanding and a happiness that Jesus is his Lord and Savior, and that one day, he's already a new creation, but one day he'll get a new body as well. We are new creations when we accept Jesus Christ. He has done away with the old and made new. And that's just an amazing part of being a Christian. I have so many testimonies, and I'm not going to get into that, but I have a metal back now. That's just it's like a sample of what newness can be and what newness brings. I cannot wait for the newness that we receive with Christ in heaven. Scripture says, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, there is a new creation. 2 Corinthians 5:17. Join us this morning in singing hymn 624, Since Jesus Came Into My Heart.
Sinking to rise the wall.
come forward at this time for our tithes and offerings. Brother Harlan, would you ask God's blessings on these tithes and offerings?
Heavenly Father, we're thankful that we can be in the house today to lift you up and worship you, Lord, to sing praises to your name. Father, we thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to give a portion of that back to you that you've given to us. We ask your blessings upon it. We ask you, Lord, that it would meet all the needs of the of your church, Lord, and all the needs of your people. In Christ's name we pray.
Great to know that the Lord is with you. He will never leave you nor forsake you. He's with us everywhere we go. If we'll stand together, sing our next hymn, 83. Be thou my vision. Psalm 16:8 says, I have set the Lord always before me.
Yeah.
surrendering all to the King. That's what worshiping is. Recognizing who we are in amongst the grace of who He is. Let the worshipers arise.
And it's like I was sitting here early this morning by myself, and I saw it, And so I listened to it. He said, listen to this with your music heart and tell me what you think it's saying. And so I did, and it's in Hindi, so I don't understand a word of it, but it made me want to dance. It's like it just had some beats to it and stuff that made me want to dance. And so as I thought about it, I sent back a message, and it's like, you know, I just feel like we're blessed because God chose to love us. And we get to worship for all of eternity because he chose to love us. And that we will get to dance. It's like, we just have to dance. It's like, one day we're going to get to dance for all of eternity in worship. There are going to be no language barriers. There are going to be no sadness. There are going to be no trials. We're just going to get to worship. And so I like to write books. So I wrote that back to him, and he wrote back, sweet Fonda, that's exactly what this song was about. And he gave me some of the words, and their words were like almost identical, which blew me away. And as we were just singing this, as the saints of every nation are awakening to sing, we are worshiping together across the globe. God does not have, he's not contained to just what we're doing right here. I'm worshiping with a brother in India that I never thought was going to be possible. I didn't know anyone in India. Don't let lyrics just slip away from you. Listen to them. Think about what they're saying. We're not up here to entertain you or to perform for you. Quite frankly, a lot of times it's a train wreck, it feels like, to us. And it's about your worship. It's about the lyrics. Even when you don't understand them.
Time and time.
Have your Bibles, turn with me to the Gospel of John, chapter 6. And Father, thank you for reminding me about envy. If you were here last week, you know that Debbie and I and all five of the Williams are going to India for our children can be dismissed, the younger children. And in September, and we're going to do a pastor's conference. We'll be training 50 pastors. And this week on Monday at Food Bank, one of our members came in, was talking with me and asked a question, said, so tell me about these pastors. And I said, well, these are pastors who basically have what we would call a high school education in Bible. So they know a little bit, but really they need training, they need encouragement, they need someone to love on them and to charge them up and send them back out, because they're working in some pretty remote places. In fact, some of them will be riding buses and trains for 30, 35, 40, 45 hours. And so some of them will leave on Sunday and not get back home until Tuesday night or Wednesday. And they're willing to do that. And the $5,000 that we were trying to raise, which we have a $2,500 matching donation. So if the church raises $2,500, there's a matching donation of $2,500, so we'll have our $5,000. That goes strictly $100 each to those 50 pastors to help get them there, but then also to put them up in Jaipur while we're there. And so that's what that is for. So when you're giving to that, that's what it will be for. It's for them. We have some funds that are for Kenny and I and for the families and that have been already donated, and that will cover our expenses. Except they still have about $11,000 to raise. So if you want to also help support them, that would be definitely a wonderful thing to do. You know, I'm waiting until Garen or Braylon or maybe even Anson has experienced I had my second time. My second time I was in India, and I was looking for a copy of the Bhagavad Gita, which is basically Hindu teachings about their afterlife. And I wanted to copy that in English so I could really understand the Hindu mind, because I knew I was going to be going back to India many times. And a man whose American name was Sandy, his Hindu name was about that long. But Sandy said, oh, I know a bookstore where they have books that are Hindi books, but in English. So he takes me and guides me through the Pink City there in Jaipur. And I get the book. He says, sir, will you come to my jewelry shop with me? Well, I'm kind of obligated. So I get with him. He was a jeweler. He was actually a Brahmin, which is the highest caste in India. They believe before you transition to Nirvana, you have to be a Brahmin, because they only transition from that state. The lower caste can't make it there. They have to come back several times. But anyway, so Sandy, I go to his jewelry store, and we're talking about different things, and I see up on the shelf a picture of Ganesh and Vishnu and some of the other gods. And so I asked him, I said, I see a lot of the gods up there, but I don't see one of Jesus. And surely you would have a picture of Jesus. And he goes, just very sincere, he goes, oh, sir, I don't believe I know him. You've never heard the name of Jesus before? He's all, no, sir. I said, can I tell you? An hour and a half later, Cindy got saved. let me fast forward about 10 or 12 years. It's one of my 20-something time to India. I've got about 30 students around me. My administrative assistant from Truett went with me also. And so we're in the Pink City. It's our last day there. We're just kind of, I do ministry first, and we shop later if there's time for it. We had one day to do some shopping so the kids can buy their trinkets and take them back home. And I hear this, Dr. Pruitt. We're in a city, and you know, 6 million people. And I'm looking around, and all of a sudden I see this guy running at me, and he lunges and he grabs me. He says, "Oh, Dr. Pruitt, it's Sandy." And Sandy had been reading his Bible. He had some questions for me. I'm waiting for these kids to see that. Until they get to lead somebody to Christ, who looks them in the eyes and says, "Oh, I'm sorry, ma'am, I don't know him." "Oh, sir, I'm sorry, I don't know him." And the people who sent me, they got to be a part of that. So when you're helping them go, or you're helping the pastors to be there, you get to, whatever God does in that trip, those churches that are affected, that their pastors are going back energized and trained in worship, and trained in how to really prepare a gospel message. When they go back to their churches, you get to be a part of that. So I do encourage you to give, because it's for a good reason. And just make sure you put on the envelope for India or for whatever, so that we'll know. And put your name on it also, so you'll get credit for it. But I am excited they get to go to India. My heart's in Thailand and India, always has been, since the first time I was in either one of those places. I just saw God do some amazing things, and he's still doing amazing things. But you know, God wants to do something amazing in your heart right here this morning. And I don't know how much you've heard of Jesus, but today we're going to hear of him. In fact, we're going to not hear of him, we're going to hear from him this morning. In John chapter 6, verse 16 through 29, I want to speak to you this morning about true or false. Now, Jesus had just fed the 5,000. He's going to walk on water here. He's performed all the other miracles. In fact, in the Gospel of John, this is the fifth miracle that is taking place in the Gospel of John. And it's really for the authentication of who Jesus really is. But I find it interesting that every time Jesus does something or says something, it actually requires a response. It requires something from us. And I find that there are those who are true believers, and they respond one way. It's in Scripture here. But those who seem to be followers, but they're not really followers of Jesus Christ, they respond another way. And that's what we're going to see in this passage. Those people who were coming over to hear Jesus, who were part of the 5,000 who'd been fed, they were not true believers, but they were followers. They called themselves followers of Jesus. They didn't follow him where he went, but they didn't follow his beliefs. They didn't follow what he taught them to do. So beginning in verse 16, he just got through feeding the 5,000. It says, "And when the evening was come, his disciples went down to the sea. They entered a ship and went over to the sea to Capernaum. And it was now dark," meaning this was late at night, "and Jesus had not yet come unto them. And the sea arose by reason of a great wind that blew. So when they had rowed for about 25 or for 30 furlongs," which is halfway across the Sea of Galilee, "they saw Jesus on the sea coming near to the ship, and they were afraid. But he said unto them, 'It is I, be not afraid.' Then they willingly received him into the ship. And immediately the ship was at the other land where they were going." So here we're halfway in the middle. As soon as Jesus steps in the boat, they're at their destination. I think there's a message there. "The day following, when the people which stood on the other side of the sea saw there was none other boat there, except the one the disciples had entered, and that Jesus was not with the disciples in that boat, but his disciples were gone away alone, howbeit other boats from Tiberias was coming up to that place, and they that ate bread entered those boats when Jesus had given thanks." So after Jesus had given thanks, they ate. Some of the boats from Tiberias made it. And so they got in the boats and went to Capernaum with them. Verse 24, "And when the people saw that Jesus was not there, neither was he with his disciples, then they took the ships they could and came to Capernaum, seeking after Jesus. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said unto him, 'Rabbi, where thou? In other words, how did you get here? That's what they're wanting to know. And Jesus answered them and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, you seek me not because you saw the miracle, but because you did eat of the loaves and you were filled. Did you notice he didn't answer their question? There's a message there. He says, labor not for the meat which perisheth, but for that meat which endureth unto everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give unto you. For him hath God the Father sealed. Then he said unto them, what shall we do that we may do the works of God? In other words, well, God, Lord, if you're not going to do what we want you to do, how can we do it? That's in essence what they're asking. You can do the works of God, but if you won't do it, how can we do it? Again, I think there's a message there. And in verse 29, and Jesus answered and said to them, this is the work of God, that you believe on him who he has sent. It's not what you do, it's what you believe. He said, this is the work of God. You want to know what the work of God is? It's not feeding 5,000 people. It's not walking on the water. What it is, it's the work of God. It's those who believe what he has said. He says, I'm sending my son. You believe in my son. That is the work of God. Now, Jesus had dismissed the 5,000 just as he had fed them. He sends his disciples away like he did often so he could go to the mountain and pray. And so they wait, and at night they cross over the sea. Now, according to Mark's account, Mark gives us a little more information from a little different perspective. Still the same exact account. But he talks about that Jesus actually sent them back to the city of where they had come from originally. And that way they could cross over to Galilee. And they were going to wait for him, but they didn't wait until because it had become dark. He said it was dark. It was probably after midnight. It was that third or fourth watch, if you will. So it wasn't the sun was going down. The sun was already down. Now, for these fishermen, that wasn't a big deal. Remember, the fishermen, they'd been out there fishing many times. Now, we know the Sea of Galilee is about 600 feet below sea level, and it's a shallow lake, so it's a shallow sea. And so when a wind comes up off those mountains, it makes a pretty good river. Kind of like Lake Pontchartrain. It did take a lot of wind to get Lake Pontchartrain rolling. It don't take a lot of wind for the Sea of Galilee to really start to churn up, and then you're fighting the wind in order to get where you're wanting to go. But the disciples, it didn't bother them. Some of them were fishermen. They'd been out there many times at night. And so they're just going ahead and they're going to go across and meet Jesus on the other side. At least that's what they think. But he's going to meet them halfway. And so also, according to Mark, which says his disciples went down and got into the boat. Matthew and Mark both tell us that his disciples made their way to the boat and give them the scripture of how that took place. And they set off for the Sea of Galilee for Capernaum. Now, according to Mark chapter 6 and verse 45, is that Jesus compelled them to go across the lake. Perhaps he saw what was taking place. Remember, those who said they were followers but not real believers in Jesus, they wanted to grab him and make him their king so he could be king over Rome, basically. In other words, he would have political influence. And no longer would Rome be the oppressor that they were to the Jewish people. So that's why they wanted to make him king. And so no doubt the disciples who knew who Jesus was, they probably were waiting for, finally he's going to get the recognition he deserves. There's people who want to make him king. And so perhaps that's the reason Jesus sent them on over, so they wouldn't be a part of that group of 5,000 and hear all that was being said about making Jesus king. Because all they wanted was somebody to fill their belly and take care of Rome. That's what they wanted, a king. Jesus is king already, but he's much above that. Why in the world, like I said, last week would he step down to some lower kingship when he is the king of all kings? But notice it says here it was already dark. Like I said, several of his disciples were fishermen, so it wouldn't bother them to go out late night and do fishing, so crossing shouldn't be a problem. And Jesus had not come to them yet, but now Matthew 8:24 tells us that when Jesus was present with him in the boat, that he rebuked the storm, and immediately they came to shore. I do find it interesting that disciples no doubt thought that Jesus was probably, he's out praying with God the Father, so he probably had forgotten all about us. They've been out there all night. The thing about this, how would you like to toil all night long from the time they left, which would be probably just about dark, all the way through somewhere 2, 3, 4 o'clock in the morning, because the Bible says it was dark. Hadn't got sunlight yet, so they've been there rowing and rowing and rowing, and normally just a couple hours they row all the way across, but the wind was fighting them. They were exhausted. They were frustrated, making not very much headway. They had only went halfway. They probably thought Jesus wasn't even thinking anything about them. But the Bible says that he did. In fact, some accounts talk about Jesus saw them. Jesus was with them the whole time. They didn't realize it. And when they saw him, you know the reason they were frightened? They thought he was, this must be a ghost. This must be some kind of an apparition. That's why Jesus said to him, "It is I. Don't be afraid." Now, sometimes when he says this erge omai, when he says that, he's speaking of deity. I am. But here he's not. Here he's telling Peter, James, John, it's me. There's no need to be afraid. It's not a ghost. It's not some apparition. It's not a spirit. It's just me. There's no need to fear. There's intimacy there. He had been watching him all along. He knew every step of the way, every row. And don't you find it interesting? They're rowing and they're rowing and they're rowing and they're rowing until he shows up. And then the Bible says, and they invited him into the boat. And when he entered the boat, immediately, no more rowing, no more toiling. They were to land. I find it interesting. It says there was a great blowing wind. Like I said, the Sea of Galilee is about 600 feet below sea level. The way the mountain rolls down in the evening, the air cools down. Next thing you know, the wind gets up. And so that was a common factor that happened often in these. Verse 19 says, Jesus comes to his disciples walking in the water. Look at verse 19. He says, so when they had rowed about 20 and 5 or 30 furlongs, that's halfway across, all of a sudden they see Jesus walking and drawing near to the ship. And they were afraid. Matthew chapter 8, verse 25 and 26 makes it clear this is the second storm that they've been with the disciples. You remember the first time he was with them? The first time is when Jesus is already in the boat. The sea's rocking and rolling. Jesus is sleeping in the back. They came to him and said, Lord, don't you even care? We're about to die. And he goes, I don't think so. And then with three words, peace, be still. So this is the second time we find Jesus in the boat with the disciples. Matthew chapter 14, verse 25, it says it happened in the fourth watch of the night, which would have been somewhere around 3, 4, or 5 in the morning before daybreak. They'd only rowed halfway across the lake. They should have been there. They should have been there, had a campfire going, already been eating fish. They probably already had some of the baskets left over of that fish and bread that was left over. They should have been on the beach cooking and waiting for Jesus to show up. But they had toiled and toiled and toiled, which tells me something. Now, Jesus is the one who told them to do this. They're following his orders. And yet, they didn't make it to the other side. You ever feel like sometimes God's give you an assignment, God's give you something to do? You're doing your best to serve him. You know you're in the will of God. And you toil, and you toil, and you toil, and you toil, and you labor, and you wonder, God, I'm not, there's no headway here. This doesn't make any sense to me. I mean, I'm doing what you are telling me to do, and I'm not making it. No doubt they were frustrated, and then he shows up, and it brings fear to them. They knew that they were doing exactly what he'd asked them to do. I think sometimes, and God doesn't want us to work in fear and frustration, but I think sometimes God lets us toil and toil and toil because we may think we're alone, but we're not. He's here with us the whole time. He knows every time we're laboring for him, when we're toiling for him, he knows exactly where we are and when we're doing exactly what we're supposed to be doing. So many times we think, well, if God says do it, it's got to be successful. But then again, we determine success by our standards and not his. I mean, from the foundation of the world, he knew this moment would come. It was pre-planned. He had a lesson to teach his disciples and also to teach those who came afterwards and also to teach us today. Notice that just because they were frustrated doesn't mean they were not doing the will of God. They were doing the very will of God. They saw Jesus walking on the sea, yet they were afraid. In Mark chapter 6, verse 49-50, it's one where it says they thought he was a spirit. And so it brought fear upon them. Disciples were not ready for that kind of supernatural deliverance. But that's why God chose to just walk on the water. I've got to admit, if I were to see the Lord doing something like that, it probably bring fear in my heart too. No matter how light you are with God, naturally it brought fear to their life. Look at verse 20. These are the common words of Jesus, the most common in all of Scripture. He says to them, it is I. Immediately, Peter, James, and John, and all that were in the boat, they would have known this is Jesus. This is him. I don't have to worry. Now, if he had said it in a way that meant, this is me as God coming to you, that's not what he said. There's intimacy here. Places this in the gospel here at a very strategic point, the way that he words it. He doesn't want them to be afraid, so he wants to make sure they are comfortable and know exactly who it is. We know from Matthew chapter 14, verse 20 through 32, after this, Peter asked him to come out and walk on the water. And Peter did walk for a short time. He walked on the water until he took his eyes off of Jesus. I think there's a message there. So many times we're out serving God, doing what God's called us to do, living our lives the best way we can as believers and followers of Jesus Christ. And all of a sudden, we get our eyes off of him. And what happens? You go astray. You start to sink. That's exactly what happened to Peter. But the Lord didn't let him drown. And the Lord's not going to let us drown either. He's going to take care of us. Look at verse 21. Jesus brings him to the destination. So many people miss this. Verse 21 says, then they willingly received him into the ship. By the way, that's the response. A true believer, when God does something or says something, a true believer receives it. And that's what happens. The moment that he steps into the boat, immediately, and that word does mean immediately, doesn't mean just a few minutes later. 1 minute, they're halfway in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. The next second, he steps into the boat, and they're on dry land on the other side. Now, if people want to know how to do it, I don't know. He's God. He can do what he wants to, how he wants to, when he wants to. But he did it, because that's what Scripture says. I love this. Then they willingly received him into the boat. The implication here is that Jesus was not getting into the boat until they asked him to. Okay, Lord, come on in. And that's the response. When God gives us something to do, when we're through a message, through a Sunday school message, we're reading our Scripture, and God gives us something to do, our response has to be, Lord, come on in. And we receive him. The others never received him. The others, all they did was question him. And by the way, that's what lost people do. People who are not followers of Jesus Christ, they always question him. And so they have a set of questions for him. I love the fact that Jesus didn't answer their questions. This is a remarkable miracle here. The reaction of the believers, we're seeing some of those first 21 verses, and then the reaction of the non-believers is seen in verse 22 through 29. Again, an event like this requires some kind of response. You're going to respond one way or another. Notice what it says here. Jesus talks about the bread of life. Look at verse 22. The following day, when the people stood on the other side and saw, there was no other boat there except for the one where the disciples had entered into, and Jesus was not with his disciples in that boat, but the disciples had went alone another way. And then they started getting in boats. And the boats from Tiberias, which, by the way, the boats coming from Tiberias, is a way of another way of letting people know the wind was blowing, because when the wind blows from that way, that's the only way you can launch a ship, is from there to get across to Capernaum. Otherwise, you're going to be toiling all day long to try to get there. It's showing, again, this is an affirmation when Scripture says, a strong wind arose. Yes, it did. You can even see it in the way they launch out the boats. But they all made it to Capernaum, and then it says, on the following day, this is the day after the miraculous feeding of the 5,000, it says, after crossing that sea that night, the crowd came to Jesus, and they had questions for him. I love the fact that they want to know, they're not asking, Lord, what is your will for our lives? What is your desire for us? What would you like for us? How can we serve you? What they want to know is, Lord, how can we get you to be our king? How can we get you to provide for us more? Lord, you filled us up. You filled us full. How can you do that for us again? Why won't you do that for us again? By the way, how did you get here? Those are not questions that a believer would ask. The crowd made sure that Jesus, when he was nowhere in the vicinity here, they were going to try to find him. You know, the Bible talks about Jesus was pursued, and this is just one of those ways that he was pursued. Look at verse 25 through 27. Jesus responds to their first question. He says, Rabbi, when did you come? How did you get here? How did you get to the other side? But instead of answering them, what would he say? Well, I walked over to the Sea of Galilee, got in the boat with my disciples, and immediately we were on dry land. That's how I got here. That's the truth. That is how he got there. But that's not what they wanted to hear. They wanted to know, Lord, this must have been another miracle, because we didn't see you. You didn't have time to walk all the way around. There was no other boats to take you, and you were not with your disciples. Well, there's got to be some trick going on here. How did you get here? And Jesus did not even respond. Now, later in this chapter, John's going to tell us that all this took place, and this questioning took place in the synagogue in Capernaum on the Sabbath day, according to John chapter 6 and verse 59. But also according to Matthew 15, the Jewish leaders from Jerusalem had joined this crowd in Capernaum for asking these questions because they wanted him to be not their spiritual leader. They wanted him to be their physical leader so that he could do things for them. It wasn't about anything about him. And then look, I love Jesus' response. You seek me not because you saw the signs. In other words, you didn't see the signs and believe. But instead, you came and you asked these questions because you ate the loaves and you were filled. So instead of telling them why he came or how he came, he tells them you're seeking after the wrong thing. And he tells them you're seeking after that which is of the flesh. And it satisfies you today, but tomorrow you're not satisfied. But what I wanted to give to you is that which satisfies you forever. And instead of taking that, what does they do? They ask another question. Okay, well, if you're not going to give us what we want, then tell us how we can get it. In other words, if you can do these miracles of God and you won't do them for us, then tell us how we can do it. How can we do the works of God? And Jesus makes it clear to them. They keep asking questions. He makes it clear to them that it's not what you do. It's what you believe. What does he say to them? He says that God's put a seal. By the way, when did God put the seal on them? And they should have known this. All the way back to John the Baptist. When the Bible says that the Spirit of God descended as a dove, and from the heavens God the Father said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." That was the authentication. That was the mark that God put on him that day saying, "This is my Son. This is my promise. This is my Messiah. I authenticate it, and you need to believe it." And that's what he says to here. He says, because the Father has set a seal on him. In other words, God's guaranteed it. God the Father guarantees you, and he guarantees me, you put your faith and trust in my Son, who was baptized by John the Baptist. I authenticate it. Scripture attests to it. We saw already there are five different testimonies of that fact that he is sealed by God. He's God's chosen. And if you'll believe, he says, you'll do the works of God, believe. Believe in the one who God has sent. And if you don't believe in him, then there's no need to believe in anything else. Because that's where true salvation comes. And so he goes through talking about the difference in the food. He says, what I want you to do is believe on the one that God has sent. Well, let's just take this passage and put it in the 21st century where we're at. That's the question. What are we seeking from God? You know, a lot of people want to get saved because they want to avoid hell. Now, that's not a bad deterrent, because I'm going to be honest with you. If you and I really get a glimpse and understand what hell is going to be like, we wouldn't want to be there. I heard a preacher one time preach five things in hell that every Christian ought to know. And I guarantee you, if we took that passage seriously, not only would we not want to go there, we wouldn't want anybody that we know. We care so much about our neighbor, we'd do whatever it took to get the gospel to him, because we would not want, it's going to be the most horrific place. We can't comprehend. Dante's Inferno. Any of you ever read Dante's Inferno? I had to read it in college. Well, yeah. And Dante's Inferno is no cakewalk. If hell was half as bad, and it's going to be 10 times worse, if not 1,000 times worse. It's a horrible, horrible place. But the question is, are we wanting God to just deliver us from hell, or are we believing what he has told us? He has told us that there was a Messiah, and his name was Jesus. He has told us that through all the scripture and all the miracles that we're going to see in John, everything validates exactly who he is. But those who continue to question God, do we question God? I don't mean that we at times question our own salvation. Sometimes we walk away from God. We get so far we don't feel the presence of God. Sometimes we begin to question our own salvation. I've been there before. I got saved when I was 18, but when I was in my mid-20s, I was in church, out of church. And every time I wondered, are you really saved? I mean, you know. But when you're walking with God, you know that you're a believer. And I don't question him. People question about the pandemic. They question about the way the world is today. By the way, I do want to remind you, and we looked at, when we were going through Proverbs chapter 3 this morning in Sunday school, you know, I was reminding my class that when I was at Florida Baptist in 1998, I had science. as one of my classes, and I had to read some scientific journals, and one of the ones I read, one of the scientists, and this was not a believer, he was saying that physicists and scientists believe that we live in a perfect, just world. Now, what does that mean? Not that God created it that way, but what he was saying is, if you realize if our planet was just 1/10 of a degree off, we'd either freeze to death or burn to death. If the solar system wasn't working the way God had planned it to work perfectly, at some points it'd be mass chaos. It'd be crashing the planets. All it'd be. God did it all. Now, science isn't giving God the credit. He just said, we live in a perfect universe. And we do, because it was created perfectly. It's man that has corrupted our world. Where we find ourselves today is not God's fault. When God created, it was perfect. And if Adam and Eve had never failed, if no one after them had ever failed, we would live in a perfect world and not have to deal with any of the junk we have to deal with today. But it's not God's fault. Again, we don't need to be questioning God. So we see true believers respond by saying, Lord, come. Just like Fonda had said earlier about, you know, India was not even on her radar until Sam John came. And I really struggle with that, about should I bring Sam or not. I mean, Sam's a dear friend I've known since 1998. He's as genuine as the day is long in the middle of August. I mean, he's a true, honest, genuine brother in Christ. But I said, okay, I'll bring Sam, and, you know, we'll take up a little love offering for him and to help his ministry, because he's got a wonderful ministry there. And next thing you know, God gets a hold of Fonda's heart, and she says, well, you know, I really don't want to get all the vaccinations I have to go, but if I have to for Jesus, I'll do it. What's she saying? She said, all things important. God, you said go, so I'll go. She's stepping out in faith. With the finances, they're stepping out in faith. Why? Because God is going to do something in the hearts and lives of those 50 pastors and their wives and their churches that only God knows what's going to happen. Now, God might not do the win. By the way, we're going to Thailand next year. You won't go to Thailand? Be praying about it, because God might choose you. God might say, I want you to go. You never know. Then after that, we'll go to Turkey the next year and Tajikistan. So first, you got a lot going on in your mind. I do. Because what it really is about is us accepting for ourselves first the truth that God has, through Jesus Christ, made a way of salvation, and we need to put our faith and trust in Him. And if we do put our faith and trust in Him, when He asks us to respond in some way, whether it's through missions or sharing right here, we need to be sharing in this community. We need to be sharing in Southport. We need to be living our daily lives that people are drawn to us. I would bet you there are people even here that may have heard the name of Jesus, but it might be through a cuss word or a slang word. But I bet you there's people here who don't even have any clue as to who He really is. And we ought to be sharing it with them too. We'll be living our lives in a way so that when they give us the, oh, sir, I'm sorry, I don't know Him. Will you let me tell you about Him? What's God saying to you today? When God touches your heart, are you responding back with, yes, Lord, get into the boat? Or are we responding back saying, well, Lord, if we can't do it your way, can we do it my way? That's what they were saying. That's what the 5,000 said. God, can we do it my way? And I know Elvis, a lot of people loved Elvis, and they loved the song that he did it his way. But it doesn't work with Jesus. We have to do it His way, not our way. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Where are you in your walk with Christ? Have you ever come to a place where you've truly said, Lord, get into the boat. Come into my life and live in me, and I'll let you live through me. If you've never done that, then that'd be a great day to give your heart to Christ. If you are a believer and you know for sure, you remember the day you give your life to Christ when you said, Lord, get in this boat and guide me where you want me to go the rest of my life. But maybe He's been giving you some directions you haven't been taking. Maybe there's something He wants you to do. Maybe there's someone at work or someone that you need to share with, because maybe they don't know Jesus the way you do. How will you respond? Were you leaving for someone else to do? Or you say, Lord, I'll take that responsibility. I'm going to share with my neighbor. I'm going to share with that guy at work. I'm going to share with whoever he lays on your heart. And by the way, God does do that. He lays people's names on your heart and on your mind. And when you can't get their name out of your mind, you know it's God doing something. And maybe he's wanting you to share with them. Maybe God's wanting you to surrender to ministry. He's still calling people today in a ministry. Maybe that's what God's calling you to do. Maybe God's calling you to be a pastor or something. Maybe God's calling you to go to school to prepare for something. Or you say, Lord, get in the boat, I'm going to follow you. Or you still ask the question, say, God, things aren't working out the way I want them to work out, but God, teach me how I can manipulate things. Are we still asking questions of him? Today, whatever God says for you, whatever he's asking you to do, will you respond by saying, Lord, get into the boat and let him take you safely to the other shore? Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this passage in the Gospel of John. God, we know that whenever you say anything to us, we know that when you do anything before us, just like you carry us through this COVID, the time when so many people were falling by the wayside, God, you protected us, you took care of us. We were able to keep the doors open. God, you've been so good to us, and we give you all the praise and the honor and the glory for all of that. God, today, we want to be faithful to you. What is it you're saying to us today? Lord, I just pray for each and every one of us here that we will hear you clearly as to what you're saying to us today, that we will respond by believing in the one whom you sent, that he would die and give his life on a low rugged cross. Be honored with our decisions today, for as in Christ's name. Amen. Let's stand together. If you're visiting,